Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and let's celebrate this beautiful Sunday evening with forecasting exchange rates. So after we went through all the issues related to corporate valuations and how companies can go to default, now we can move on to the second, or in this case the third chapter if you are counting the first chapter case study. So in this case, obviously, there is an introductory part, but since you learned international finance at me, and you know all these anomalies and issues, so it's not necessary to talk about the same thing again, so you can read it to refresh your memories. So let's go ahead and focus on much more interesting phenomena, because in this chapter we were talking about forecasting methods, way of forecasting, then after that how to identify exposures, what kind of exposures are there to identify, then to talk about currency derivatives, with lots of them, how can we model them and how can we price them and what are their functions are, and also managing transaction exposures, so actually risk management at the end of the day. So, yeah, go ahead. For this case, we will choose Czech koruna to Hungarian forint exchange rate because this is much more fun to see how two open and small economies and their currencies are struggling under our modern times of COVID and openness and crisis and in the shadow of the ECB operations. So, it'll be fun. And to do so, we are using open source approaches. So mostly I was downloading the data from Stoku. If I was not downloading the data from Stoku, then it was downloaded from Eurostat databases. So yeah, thank you for Stoku people to providing us your data, because it's nice. And so first of all, then we have to talk about exchange rates and forecasting. Obviously, what we have to see is that how company and or corporate business strategy will react or will deliver under different circumstances. So at least what this forecasting should be able to provide us is some sort of median or mode of the or expected value of the exchange rate, so what is the which has the highest probability in the near future, so within the next business year, and also some low probable scenarios to simulate the rainy days. So let's see that, how can we do this. First of all, we can focus on historical trends, then also, we can have simulations, so that's why we were playing with Gauge simulations. Also, it can be war forecasting. And at the end of the day, we can say that, okay, but what are the market ideas? So let's see market assumptions, so futures, that which can be also useful, because actually market bets has also nice meaning and suggestion and value here. Okay, so in this first video I will talk about historical trends, so what can happen with exchange rates. So first of all, let's look on this exchange rate. So in Excel, if we download something, then we can generate a nice graph on it. We have dates, now it looks much better, and actually this is what we get here. Of course, we can say that, what is, or we can say, we can ask the question, and what was the exchange rate regime amongst these currencies? So, are they both floating, or they were fixed, or what happened with them? Actually, if we are looking on the Hungarian forint, then we can say Ah, where is it? So from 2001 until 2008, early spring, so it was March, like, if I remember well, it was the first week of March in 2008, because this was the first time when we had complexity on capital markets, which was my second lecture to keep. And actually, until this point, the Hungarian forint had a fluctuation band, but it was a really wide fluctuation band. So in this case, we can say that HUF had a plus minus 15% of fluctuation band against the euro. Then it was abandoned. So the second window can be described that since this point, since it was abandoned, Hungarian forint is free floating. In the case of Czech koruna, actually, it's free floating, but there was a period between 2013 November and 2017 April. Let's give a green color for that. Well, actually, Czech or Czech koruna exchange rate had a floor against the euro at 24. So, because there was a sharp appreciation of the Czech koruna and they wanted to avoid it, so that's why they introduced this. It was a Swiss franc-like regime, just it was not that dramatic and nobody cared about it outside Central Europe, so yeah, they introduced it, and after that, sooner or later, they abandoned it because the central bank was communicating it that actually the danger of further deflation disappeared from the markets, so they don't want to have this extraordinary exchange rate ceiling, which was much more a tool for an additional tool for unconventional measurements. Yeah, so, but by the way, we can say that otherwise, mostly Czech koruna and forint was in a floating stage. Okay, maybe here it was a bit managed, but anyways, we can say that it was nice. So if we are fitting a trend line on it, what can we see? Adding trend line, we can add, at the beginning, let's give a linear line for that. So let's have the equation and the R square, and what can we see here? So actually, this is the steepness. Maybe I will increase font size, because in this case it can be visible also on YouTube. So it has a positive steepness. Let's assume that we have this linear trend line, then actually we can trace back that what can be the exchange rate if we are following or tracing this linear trend. So, first of all, let's see how this linear trend will operate, so in our trend line, and let's see that where it goes to zero. So we can look on this and we can assume that it goes back until it reaches zeros and disappears. So it goes zero at so we can assume that in this case actually now it works like this. Then it goes to zero. So this is the weak zero actually from the trend line point of view. Then we know also that it arrives to a data set around 9.5. actually we can have better assumption if we are just zooming in and let's see that 0.5 is the main. Oh, it's brilliant. Okay, so we don't need further investigations here. So it goes, it reaches 9.5 when the same equation will be you learned it in grammar school, so this is the beginning of our data set. Let's check it back. Okay. And also we know that it leaves so it provides last known data. So let's see that it leaves our data set at 13. Yep, just backtesting it. It happens. So actually, X passes. Here was minus this thing, and we know that weeks passed was 770. So actually we know it's nearly a week. We were using weekly data, so funny. Okay. So this is what is represented here. So to have linear forecast by only using Excel, and in this case, we know that 1 year later, so this is 1 week represented by X numbers. So let's multiply it by this number here, and also we have to add it to our latest coordinates. So this. And we can hope that this thing will work. and operate well, and it forecasts us that it will be 17.24 Czech kronas. Okay, we can live with that. This is a number. So this is the most simplest assumption here. Actually, we can see that R square is good enough. And how long can we does it take? So it's, we can estimate. We can have this estimation within 10 minutes. It's not that sophisticated, but it's still doing its job. Obviously, you can say that let's have more, better, sophisticated trend lines. Just the problem is that this is not exponential, far from exponential. It's not logarithmical. We can say that polynomial, we can fit some lines on it, but you know that in polynomials there is always the endpoint problem, that at the latest point of the assumption or fitting at the beginning, it always has the or contains the highest uncertainty. So that's why it generates you additional noise. Or we can say that it can be a moving average. But if you are looking for simple stuff, then linear trend line on a long enough data, we can have some nice assumptions. And also we can say that this is the median expected value, and also we can calculate that and what was the standard deviation of this or standard error. Then we can calculate it and we can add to it, and then we can see that how it changes. So this is the simplest solution. At least it gives us one idea that the slope is positive, so Hungarian forint should continuously depreciate against the Czech koruna. This is all what we got here.